for coming for our side event.
Microphone.
We've been participating in a street protest in our country, so we have voice.
Thank you for coming. Yeah, it's better with microphone. Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming for this side event on kleptocracy versus democracy, the biggest issue for post-Soviet countries. My name is Violeta Moskalu. I am a doctor in management sciences, working in teaching in universities in France and some different countries worldwide. And I am the founder of Global Ukraine Foundation. We created it after the Euromaidan revolution in Ukraine in order to develop a global Ukrainian network for Ukrainian expatriates living in more than 80 countries. We organized the different Global Ukrainians Forum, and we are really very focused on how Ukrainian immigrants and expatriates, highly educated, globally connected, could help Ukraine in this transformation time after the Euromaidan revolution. Why this topic? Because we understand that our post-Soviet countries, like Ukraine, Moldova, Azerbaijan, and others, are de facto in a transition period. And in different countries, we have kind of oligarchic regimes. And the issue is how to transform, how these countries could be strong democracies. And one of our important point underlined by different academics and people working interested by the political sciences is that we cannot analyze the developing countries using the same tools and analytics approach we are used to use in our Western democracies. Because there are some points like mentality linked to the mentality of ruling elites, and this mentality of ruling elites is defined like being developing or predatory. So mentality of ruling elites is one of the strong explanation point. Like why some countries are in a on a developing way, and others are like in more predatory or extractive economy situation. So we will try to understand why this is important and how to. To define maybe a better strategy how to help these countries in their way on towards democracy. So the kleptocracy has a strong impact inside but also outside the countries. When you have ruling elites who put their own economic interest on a, like for whom their economic interests are more important than the national interest, and who when you have economic elites and political elites doing politics, like doing business, and thinking that politics is all about business and it's all about their own economic interests and not about the national interests. It's we have some results like a lot of poverty in the countries, lack of economic development, human rights activists persecutions inside the country with these kleptocratic regimes, corruption and huge migrants issues also on the international level. So today we want to discuss some to try to summary maybe some points and to put the question how our international aid development programs should be adapted maybe, and which other political and governance instruments could be used. So we have some very distinguished guests and speakers with us today. Let me introduce to you Ms. Domnica Manole. She is our special guest from Moldova, the former judge of Appellate Court of Chișinău. Ms. Domnica is a judge with 27 years experience in judicial system. Today she is a political prosecutor for the refusal to fulfill the political task during the judgment. She will explain us how kleptocratic regimes use which instruments and how can they capture the government, public administration institutions and judicial institutions, and which are the bad results linked to this. Ms. Ana Ursachi, she's a lawyer and a human rights defender from Moldova, who is living in exile in Poland because of also of political persecution. She's been subjected in her country after working in political sensitive cases, and she will try to explain us also a situation about inside the country and also how these regimes become toxic for outside also. And Mr. Emin Huseynov, a famous journalist from Azerbaijan, who is the executive director of the Institute for Reporters' Freedom and Safety. Azerbaijani journalist and human rights activists also living in exile in Switzerland today. So maybe we can start with a question to Ms. Domnica Manole. Can you explain us from your point of view how do you understand the kleptocratic regime, and how it is possible to capture, because some years ago one European Union political leader said that Moldova is a captured state. How it is possible from a point of view of a judge and explaining the judiciary institutions, how they are captured and why it's very bad for the development of rule of law in your country? Thank you. I think 5-7 minutes for a speech, and we can discuss later.
Уважаемые дамы и господа, уважаемые дамы и господа, я попытаюсь вкратце объяснить, какая у нас политическая ситуация в стране. Клептократия это характеризует напрямую политическую систему в Молдове. Конечно, спонсоры этого тоталитарного режима являются страны, как Россия, в первую очередь, и Китай на международном уровне, и Молдова как страна постсоветского пространства, где демократия является на начальном уровне, где демократия является поверхностным, то, конечно, есть стремление к тому, чтобы привлечь или ввести тоталитарные режимы в нашей стране.
Should I translate? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, gentlemen, my name is Domnica Manole, I'm a judge from the Republic of Moldova. I will try to explain briefly why the kleptocracy is so dangerous for the Republic of Moldova, because we are a country with a young democracy, which is on the beginning level, and I will try to explain how dangerous could be all the the kleptocratic effects of on our country, because they are mostly coming from Russia. Even the China is well known in the world that are kind of promoter of kleptocracy. But as to our country, we unfortunately have to speak about the Russian influence and about the Russian example of kleptocracy.
По моему мнению, развитие таких стран является прямой опасностью для развития демократии во всем мире. В Республике Молдова это отражается в первую очередь путем захвата государственных органов. У нас практически эти органы захвачены правительственной партией, захватом органов юстиции, на этом, как доказательство того, что захвачены органы юстиции, могу привести пример, когда в этом году, в мае месяце, в Кишиневе, столице Молдовы, имели место местные выборы, выборы примара города Кишинева. Выиграл выборы представитель оппозиционной партии большинством голосов. И когда консилиум обратился в суд, чтобы легализировать данные выборы, суды по своей инициативе признали эти выборы недействительными.
Of course, from my experience, the most dangerous effect is that the justice is captured in our country, and the kleptocratic regime is taking under his control everything which is relating to justice and to normal delivery of justice in courts. And the most recent example is that the election of the mayor of Kishinev, which were held in summer. In the beginning of the summer 2018, were cancelled, were invalidated by the court because of the will of the ruling elite. And this is one of the most fearless examples, and they are linked, this kind of examples are linked to the total dependence of the judges from the political will. Because of the fact that those judges who were independent and who refused to fulfill political tasks, they were persecuted. And their example have been used to fear and to treat another judges.
Могу пояснить еще один пример захвата судебной власти. Проявилось еще в том, что я в качестве судьи апелляционной палаты вынесла решение по референдуму. То есть оппозиционная партия собрала более 400 тысяч подписей, обратилась в избирательную центральную комиссию, чтобы им разрешили провести референдум по изменению Конституции. Вопрос этого референдума были такие, чтобы можно было президента страны избрать народным голосованием. Центральная избирательная комиссия отказала им в проведении данного референдума. В итоге это дело попало в суд. Я рассмотрела в соответствии с законом, вынесла решение обязать избирательную комиссию провести всенародный референдум по изменению Конституции.
And this is my example, unfortunately, my story, how I got be prosecuted in my country, because in 2016 I was judging a case about validation of the results of the popular referendum, which was held in 2015, and it was the result of the initiative of the opposition parties, for what were gained more than 400,000 signatures. People were trying to put the question on the popular referendum about direct voting of the president of the country. That was the will of the people who are living in the Republic of Moldova. And because the ruling elite disagreed with this kind of initiative, mostly because it was issued by opposition, Dominika Manoli she received threats and a direct political command to cancel the results of the referendum, and she refused. She just executed the law, and after that she was in a very short term she was prosecuting herself, being dismissed from the office and being subjected to the criminal fabricated case.
Следует пояснить, что в Республике Молдова по вине вот этих олигархов, которые находятся во главе власти, значит, более 10 лет в Республике Молдова не было возможности провести ни одного референдума. И это решение вызвало бурю поддержки со стороны народа, но недовольство политика, и в итоге, значит, как уже сказали, было возбуждено уголовное дело. Проявляется вот этот захват, проявляется и на уровне органа самоуправления судебной системой. Орган самоуправления не является независимым, и поэтому любое политическое желание является, исполняется через этот орган самоуправления в отношении судей. Да, в которых участвует генеральный прокурор, министр юстиции, председатель высшей судебной палаты и участвуют еще представители, которые назначаются парламентом.
Another example is also coming from the judicial system. It's about the Superior Council of Magistrates in Moldova, which is total dependent on the political will, and mostly because one of the members of Superior Council of Magistrates is a general prosecutor and another is Minister of Justice. So judges have no protection from such a Council of Superior of Magistrates. More than that, they are all usually subjected to different critics and disciplinary administrative proceedings, which are a kind of ringing bell before the opening of the criminal case. So the judge have to decide for himself or herself what is to do when you want to live safe in the Republic of Moldova. If you are not doing or executing political orders, you are firstly subjected to disciplinary proceedings by this Council of Magistrates, and after that you are dismissed from the office and subjected to the criminal prosecution.
Под предлогом, что это внутренние дела страны, у нас преследуются не только судьи, возбуждаются уголовные дела, но преследуются и адвокаты, которые защищают в соответствии с законом права человека. У нас преследуются и представители оппозиционных партий, представители гражданского общества. Даже вот на моем конкретном случае, хотя были высказаны мнения по поводу недопустимости уголовного преследования судьи за вынесенное решение, но каждый раз правительство, даже премьер-министр высказывается, что это внутреннее дело страны. Хотя мы подписали соглашение о присоединении к Европейскому Союзу, и этим соглашением мы обязались соблюдать международные стандарты в области не только независимости судов, но и в других областях.
One of the characteristic of this kleptocratic regime is the fact that they are denying the truth, and one again a concrete example: when our prime minister was asked about the case of Dominika Manoli and the huge violations of human rights and rule of law in her case, because it's absolutely incredible how a judge could be prosecuted because of the normal delivery of the judgments, he was saying that there are internal affairs of the country, that justice in the Republic of Moldova is independent. Even everybody knows, even there are a lot of reports and a lot of international reactions about the fact that justice is not independent, justice is captured in the Republic of Moldova, and the judicial system is totally failed. Even everybody knows this fact. Our political elite, when they are speaking and where they are, if they've been asked about what's going on in the Republic of Moldova and why so much cases of political persecution of lawyers, human rights activists, whistleblowers, judges have been conducted for the last few years in the Republic of Moldova, they are trying to cover the truth with the argument that it's an internal affairs and you cannot interfere with the internal affairs because you cannot interfere. Okay, I will try to shorten.
Еще один момент, который я хочу подчеркнуть, что не может быть правового государства, не может быть развития демократии, если не соблюдается принцип разделения властей, законодательная власть, исполнительная власть и судебная власть. К сожалению, хотя бы в Республике Молдова это закреплено в Конституции, принцип разделения властей, на самом деле этот принцип не соблюдается, нарушается. То есть имело место захват тех и всех тех государственных структур из исполнительной власти, или что представляет исполнительную власть, и судебную власть. Какие рекомендации я бы высказала бы в конце?
Well, shortly, another example, well-known example, is undermining of the principle of separation of powers, because from concrete examples from our country, we can understand now that the executive power, legislative and judiciary are in one hand, and unfortunately these hands are not official. It's a person who is an oligarch staying behind of the ruling government. And Dominika wants to share with us some recommendations she would have about the situation and how to improve the situation in Moldova.
Maybe we will look by on another side, on another example, and in the second part we'll speak about some recommendations. So thank you very much, Dominika, for explanations on how your judiciary system institutions are used in the interests of the oligarchic regime. Let's look to another case, and also with much lot of examples of persecutions against human rights activists and journalists and people who fight for freedom and for democracy and for good governance in the post-Soviet region. Emin Hussein, your case is very symbolic because you are fighting for freedom and for democracy in Azerbaijan from at least 15 years, maybe later. In your point of view, some examples, can you show us how the kleptocratic regimes use all the instruments possible and imaginable and non-imaginable for a normal people in your country? Thank you.
Thank you. Unfortunately, kleptocracy is not a problem only in Azerbaijan. In all OIS region, we have many states which is clear examples of kleptocracy. I want to start with my country, but it's also many countries in the Central Asia region, like Kazakhstan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan. And previously we have same examples in Kyrgyzstan, which is right now in much, much better condition. Also, our neighbor country, like Armenia, which has recently had this democratic or revolutionary transitions, but we're still looking what's happened there. and government, which is the place previous kleptocracy regime, Sarkisyan, they are promised to fight against corruption. But the same examples we observed in another our neighbor country, Georgia, but unfortunately in some states like Ukraine, or you see it's Moldova, which is also our partners in Eastern Partnership EU program. This is looks for, we still, even some countries which is have to chance or few chances to cross for from dictatorship to democratic regime. It's this problem with kleptocracy is still the same. But I just now would want to return back to Azerbaijan and give for maybe one of the worst examples in the world. Unfortunately, it's my own state. And recently, all of you maybe know, for we have constitutional reforms, which is amendments provide to ruling regime completely occupy unlimited for his own interest. And today in my state, if you look who is the head of the state and second person in the state, it's very clear. President appointed his own wife to vice president positions. And right now we don't have even competition in social and political life. This is competition between two members of family. This is two clans of Pashaevs, which is represented by first lady and first vice president, and Ali, which is represented old ruling clan. And if you try to understand why this happened, unfortunately I'm 39 years old, but 45 years in my country we have Ali's kleptocracy from 1969 until 1989. We have communist first secretary, Heydar Aliyev, and in very short break, like which is continued 2.5 years after this, he's organized a coup and coming back to ruling power. And since from 1993 until 2003, we have again his presidency, which is named like second president of democratic Azerbaijan. But in 2003, when he died, he transferred his presidential power to his son. And his clever son changed constitution, which is also maybe one of the clear precedent in example in Council of Europe or in OSCE story, when head of the state decide by himself to change, not like one, but like it's triple change, which has happened in 2001, 2009, and 2016 finally. And according to this constitutional amendments, now we have unlimited presidential terms, 7 years for one presidential term, which is they cross from 5 years to 7 years. And if we look to the recent political development, the Aliyev just decide as like Maduro to organize snap elections. Elections which we all of us believe for, we have elections in October of this year. Unfortunately, Aliyev organized snap elections in April, and right now we must to live in this very difficult condition. When we say we, it's 10 million of Azerbaijan population, which is don't have any profit from all goods which is our countries have from last 15 years. And according to international organizations and local investigative journal community, from last 20 years, we have $160 billion income from our oil export and gas export. But unfortunately, more than 50 billion of this, which is more than 30% of all our income, stealing by ruling elite. And unfortunately, again, this money stealing by assistance of Western financial systems. They are not stealing money just like, this is not $1. They're using like SWIFT, they're using European bank system and recent scandal with Azerbaijan laundromat story, which is published year ago by International Investigative Journalist Consortium. There looks like one example give clear pictures for when in 2012 and until 2014, ruling family only by one small bank in Estonia, they organized money laundering for 3 billion euros. And most of this money they are using for buying illegal, expensive luxury property in the Europe. They are still using this property there, in France, in Italy, in Spain, even in Switzerland. And also, they try to position themselves, or they really try to do the best for his own people. They control everything in our life, started from, and they control it by very successful propaganda, all media, all political life, parliament, or independent judgment, everything is fake in Azerbaijan. We don't have anything real, and it's very sad when we say, for even compared with Moldova and Ukraine, our nations from last 25 years of our independence don't have any chance for democratic transitions. And again, the reason is for this kleptocracy. Motivation by our ruling family. And I want to conclude my bit sad and hopeless presentation, what the OSCE must do. Many states, even US administration in 2006, George Bush made like his speech about the role of the U.S. is fighting against the kleptocratic regime. But still, until today, if we look around, nobody really interested to discuss about this. First of all, because this is dangerous. In my own state, very limited numbers of journalists still able to investigate this corrupt regime. Most of the critical voices in the prison, my own brother, which is one of the famous anti-corruption lawyer, Mehman Hussein, he tortured, he's arrested. I'm talking about his case in few plenary sessions. We lost our family members. Another investigative journalist also have many, many problems. And irony of this story for sometimes government try to fight against his critics with same logic. They say, "For we are corrupted guys. Independent NGOs, which is investigated corruption, they are initiated criminal case against us with tax, abuse of power, tax evasion, etc. But still, all OEC member states until today don't implement even any sanctions. They are continued using the financial system. And again, we are going to all OEC member states, which is respect these values, which is belief for all government must be accountable in front of its own people and in front of the global community. OEC need to find solutions with to prevent this cancer, which is paralyzed all community. At least half of the OEC member states today have serious problem with corrupted government. It's some of these governments, it's clear kleptocracy. Another one, it's always able to implement like kleptocracy, like Azerbaijan, Russia, or Kazakhstan. Anyway, according our positions, day by day it's difficult to these authoritarian regimes easily to organize this money laundering activities, but still development, which is we observe, it's not enough for completely find solutions with these difficulties. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I mean, maybe one more decision. They are just going until taking away your passport and your citizenship, just to avoid you to come back to the country. So it's also a very bad point because we also saw such kind of initiatives in different countries, where the passport is like also an instrument to fight against opposition leaders or activists or dissidents. So we did some advocacy campaign explaining that these countries are not feudal countries, and that citizenship is something that cannot allow to anyone. Thank you, Emin, and maybe Anna, you can develop also all these ideas and also try to show us how these regimes become toxic also for not only for their own people and their own nation, but also for around in countries and for European Union countries also. The whole world. Thank you.
Thank you, Violeta. Good morning, everyone again. So, Moldova is a clear example of a country which is living in kleptocracy. To give some brief examples, let's go back a little bit to 2014. At the time when Moldova has signed an association agreement, it was the same year when the parliamentary election took place in our country. And the Democratic Party, which now is being considered as political elite, so-called political elite in the Republic of Moldova, came to so-called power because they entered after the parliamentary election in 2014, they entered in parliament with less than 15%, so having 11 seats in the legislative, but at the approximately at the end of the second half of 2015, Plahotniuk, who is the leader, we have an oligarch in the Republic of Moldova, the only one oligarch who is keeping control of the state, the only one oligarch who is now the most rich and powerful person in the Republic of Moldova, the most dangerous. He is a formal leader of Democratic Party, and to the second part of 2015, Democratic Party gained using blackmail and using different possibilities to open criminal fabricated cases, using bribe also. These are proved examples which are already recognized, they have been already recognized by the international community. So he managed to obtain 52 seats in parliament. Even he entered in parliament with 11 seats. This is the one example of how the kleptocracy could be spread and how the legislative power could be captured. Because after he obtained the so-called parliamentary majority from people who were leaving their parties and their factions, and they are just joining Plahotniuk because of pride and because of fear to be imprisoned, as we had a lot of examples of such kind, he obtained the possibility to vote to promote all laws he wants. So after 2015, despite of big street protests which were organized in the Republic of Moldova, and people were protesting against corruption, against the biggest haste of the century, this disappearance of the $1 billion of dollars from the national reserve in the Republic of Moldova. Despite of all the actions of civil activists, opposition, which are quite strong in the Republic of Moldova, he managed to vote and to promote such kind of laws which were very important to keep the power and to distribute this toxic oligarchic and kleptocratic influence in the region, not only in the Republic of Moldova. For example, recently this so-called parliamentary majority had adopted a law about the amnesty of the capital. So now, in the Republic of Moldova, if you are paying 3% to the government, to the state, you cannot provide the information about the origin of your money. So still, all the whole world is fighting with the money laundering. Moldova is just making a very favorable situation to all those who want to hide the origin of their money just because they have the possibility to pay 3% to the government. Another strange and, of course, unacceptable from the European standards law was about the granting the citizenship of the Republic of Moldova for 200,500 euro. So if you pay now, and it's a recent law adopted by this, I repeat again, so-called parliamentary majority, which was joined one to each other because of bribery and blackmail. So this parliamentary majority now voted a law that everybody who can pay 215,000 dollars on euros, they can have Moldovan citizenship and participate in internal life of Moldova and buy goods and properties in the Republic of Moldova, and of course maybe take benefits of the fact that Moldova won't extradite his own citizens. So terrorists and criminals are welcome in the Republic of Moldova because a kleptocrat who is staying behind of the government wants so. And while we are really afraid that a lot of terrorists and criminals from all over the world will come in Moldova to have this, to buy the citizenship in order to protect themselves, we had recently a very scaring case about the kidnapping and illegal expulsion from Moldova of 7 Turkish citizens. Just because Erdogan and our president Dodon, who is a pro-Russian one, are agreed so. Unfortunately, Dodon even didn't manage to hide the fact that last summer he was in his vacation, his holiday, on the Erdogan villa and the Erdogan yacht. So it's an official fact that they are our president and Erdogan. They have close relationship, and it's another sign how this kind of doubtful friendship could be used against the interest of the country just because Dodon is, how to say, kind of prolongation of the hand of Plahotniuk, is the same of what does it mean? Plakhotnyuk is the same, that means Dodon. They are trying to play a role, Plakhotnyuk trying to pretend pro-European. Recently he gave up to pretend as being pro-European and he declared that now his party will be heading to the pro-Moldova course. I can't explain for me what is pro-Moldova course, especially when such a statement is saying by an oligarch. But I wanted to be clear, President, Russian President Dodon and oligarch Plakhotnyuk are the same guy. And this kidnapping of the seven, very shameful fact of kidnapping of the seven Turkish citizens was organized by the chief of Moldovan secret services. His name is Vasily Bodner. And I want to afford, I don't know, some 30 seconds to this man, who used to be former director of the Moldova Gas company, state company, which is a part of Gazprom. So now, today, in the Republic of Moldova, which is until now taking benefits from EU taxpayers' money, which is receiving a lot of, which has received a lot of billions of European and USA money, a person who was appointed as to be director of the state company, Moldova Gas state company, which is directly linked at his appointment took place in Moscow when President Dodon went to Putin to speak about his appointment. Now he held the position of the chief of secret services in the Republic of Moldova. This is a clear example what kleptocracy could do in a small country. And because Violeta asked me to refer about the taxation, about the fact that how dangerous this phenomenon could be for the region, I want to say that such examples of kidnapping persons in order to be extradited to the Republic of Moldova, we registered also in Ukraine when Poroshenko did the same thing because it was asked for Plakhotnyuk, and we registered the same things unfortunately in Romania, where ruling party is using the same tools as Plakhotnyuk in order to cut the protesting wave in the Republic, in our countries. That's in order to prosecute those who protest in the streets, in order to treat them, to beat, to put police, to apply gas on the protesters. And the same phenomenon we have in Romania, which is a country part of European community. Only because, again, it's official information, we have the truth that Dragnea and Plakhotnyuk are close friends and they are promoting the same politics. As well as Plakhotnyuk and Poroshenko are close friends and they are promoting the same politics. And as well as Dodon is directly related to Putin and they are promoting Russian politics in all this region. More than that, for example, if we are speaking about captured media as a sign of some kind of kleptocratic damages which could be done to the democracy, I want you to know that today the Republic of Moldova, which received a lot of European money to fight with Russian propaganda and really received a big amount of money to implement laws against Russian propaganda, 6 TV channel, 4 of them owned by Plakhotnyuk and 2 of Dodon, are broadcasting Russian propaganda, not fighting and broadcasting Russian propaganda. So they put on the paper, one, because European community asked them so and gave them money, and they implement a total different thing. So we are not fighting Russian propaganda, we are just broadcasting constantly Russian propaganda from our TV channels, and Plakhotnyuk for the moment is controlling more than 80% of he's covering more than 80% of media, which is controlling and issued information on his behalf. For example, we had fact such situation when recently at the bilateral meeting with of our Ministry of Internal Affairs and German Ministry of Internal Affairs, Moldovan officials received very huge critics from the German authorities. They told that they will stop any kind of collaboration with Moldova, any kind, including on the judiciary and on the financial part, because of lack of democracy and undermining rule of law and this scandal with election and expelling those seven teachers. And as in the evening we received, just as a second, in the evening we received news on all this controlled by Plahotniuk media propaganda that everything is okay, German is welcome, the Republic of Moldova, to go into development of European values and so on and so forth.
Can you say us also some words about how it's possible to use Interpol tools also against the activities? And later we will switch to recommendations and some looking for new ideas.
Yeah, unfortunately, it's a very good tool for all kleptocratic regime to use to abusive tools and to use Interpol against those who are speaking against the government and who are delivering the truth. Here in European community, I am the one of such victims. I've been persecuted in my country because I was a defense lawyer in my 17 years career as a criminal lawyer. For the last 5 years, I had a lot of politically sensitive and high-profile cases where I was defending the opposition to the ruling elite and mostly the persons who were able to deliver very dangerous information against them. For example, person who used to live in their inner circle, but after that decided to testify, for example, in the case of stolen billion, or to testify in the case of laundering of 25 billion of Russian money on the territory of Republic of Moldova using judicial system. So such a dangerous information for Plahotniuk was cut it because all those persons, all whistleblowers who were brave enough or courageous enough or have different other interests to testify were imprisoned, and lawyers, me and other lawyers, were subjected to criminal prosecution and expelled from the country. When I was in Berlin in 2016 speaking during the OC conference about all this not very known facts, because as well as Dominika said, our officials are trying to deny everything about the truth of Moldova speaking, and what are they're asking, they are just explaining its internal affairs. We will explain you one day the reports we will issue at the end of the year, but for now everything is okay, and please don't interfere in our internal things. So to fight with propaganda is very difficult, and I was the one, when I was speaking in Berlin on the OC conference, I find out that in Moldova they issued a criminal case, the government issued a criminal case against me, and the warrant arrest was also issued. Due to the big international pressure, it was very hard to deliver this warrant arrest, but they somehow managed. In March 2018 they arrested me, and I was immediately put in Interpol. Because before the 2018 I was participating in different programs how to reform Interpol, I can say that a lot of misuse of Interpol power and a lot of abusive tools in Interpol are provided by kleptocratic regime. For example, now the chief of the Interpol is a Russian citizen. The chief of one of the biggest representatives in the board is a Chinese citizen. A Moldovan citizen controlled by Plahotniuk, about whom we know, and it's again proved, that he was involved in the disappearance of 13 pages from the Plahotniuk Interpol file, now held a very important position in Europol. Until now, because now he returned in Moldova to serve Plahotniuk. And also probably you have heard about Vitaly Berlok, who is the chief of the Commission for Control Fines in Interpol, the commission which is able to decide which case is political motivated, which case is not. So with the aid with Vitaly Perlov, who is a Moldovan citizen appointed by Plahotniuk and promoted by oligarch Plahotniuk and Interpol, a lot of countries, a lot of dictatorship countries could join in order to prosecute their opposites. And we had such an example in September 2017. 600 Turkish citizens were put in red notice in Interpol just because of misuse, and it was this misuse of delivering from Commission of Control Files, which president is director, not president, is Vitaly Perlov. And at the same time, we registered that Plahotniuk, Dodon and Erdogan have met in Istanbul. Well, maybe yes, about the recommendation, when it's time, I think I know it.
Thank you very much. It's, yeah, it could be developed, but now my question is how can we change something, because when we see now a huge number of countries, we speak now about post-Soviet region, but it's also looking on Africa continent, where a lot of countries with huge resources, but where we saw extractive economies, so kleptocratic regimes using and abusing of power for doing business, stealing money for buy luxury villa in Europe, for example. They are not no investment in their own countries. I did some number of technical assistance projects in Haiti and Guinea and Ivory Coast and other countries, and it's really very strange to see how this lack of investment leads to infrastructure degradation and to poverty, and finally civil society and people, citizens just lose their hope to some democratic changes, and they finally vote by their feet, because they leave the countries for others where some more development is possible. So the migration is a direct result of this kleptocratic style of governance, of bad governance. We speak about good governance, but actually we have a huge number of countries with very bad governance regime. And my point is, how can we maybe review our traditional approach, because the civil society is weak in these countries. Some activists, some journalists, some oppositions are doing a lot, but it's like very, it's not enough, because the regime is really very strong with media, with economic, financial institutions and the resources, and political also. So civil society is weak, and it's persecuted, and it's clear that they are not able to change the situation by themselves, and themselves. And looking on international institutions, looks like we have maybe some questions also to put about our capacity to do changes, to obtain the expected changes, the expected results with technical assistance and the financial assistance for these countries, because the examples we discussed this morning looks like show that it's we don't obtain the expected results. So maybe just some points without developments, but your ideas was which recommendations from the point of view of for the judicial reform, for example, for Ms. Dominika Manoli, how do you think how the judicial system can be reformed by your own experience?
Ну, для того, чтобы реформировать судебную систему, наверное, в первую очередь нужно провести демократические выборы в стране по демократическим нормам,
и избрать новую политическую власть в стране. Только тогда, имея политическую власть, имея политическое желание, я считаю, можно провести реформу, настоящую реформу в судебной системе.
I think any kind of reforms could be conducted in such countries as ours. Only one ruling elite will be healthy, a normal ruling elite, and only after democratic elections, when healthy forces will come to power, hopefully. Honestly, I don't believe about this in short time in Moldova.
Только с избранием новой политической власти можно будет говорить о том, что исключено, о том, чтобы исключить политическое вмешательство в органы правосудия и обеспечить принцип разделения властей. Но для того, чтобы обеспечить развитие демократического государства, я считаю, что, учитывая ситуацию Молдовы и других стран, которые избрали путь тоталитаризма, необходимо в первую очередь обеспечить прозрачность в деятельности правительства. Необходимо демократизировать политическую жизнь, обеспечить независимость всех государственных структур общества, в том числе обеспечить независимость масс-медиа. К сожалению, в Республике Молдова, значит, только два телеканала являются независимыми, а все остальные являются подчинены политической власти и не отражают реальную ситуацию в республике и на международном уровне. Еще один момент. Я считаю, что очень важно укрепить еще гражданское общество в стране. Чем известно, что чем ниже социальное развитие, тем слабее гражданское общество. И тогда, вот там, где слабое гражданское общество, тогда идет и развитие коррупции.
Well, because delivering our hope and our purposes for which we will be fighting for, to have finally a democratic our democratic choice, and our choice is obviously not this kleptocratic governance, and our choice is to regain the separation of powers and do not admit the immixtion of the politics in judiciary. And we hope we will be able to return to the transparency of the public politics. And all these goals could be achieved, of course, only with the international support and with the international strongest reaction on the side of the persons who are really fighting for European and normal values, and with a strong condemnation of such kind of processes which are now with a high toxicity are ruling in Moldova and next to Moldova countries.
Thank you very much. In 2 minutes, Emin, from your point of view, is it enough how can we think about more pressure, maybe, or what are your expectations from international institutions, for example?
Unfortunately, OECD don't have any maybe capacity or political will to fight against corruption in the OECD member state. Only one international document which is give us these possibilities, UN corruption, anti-corruption convention, which is adopted in 2003, if I'm not mistaken. But still, for example, in Azerbaijan case, where Azerbaijan parliament ratified and joined this convention in 2005, but last 13 years, Azerbaijani government don't find political will to implement even small obligations, which is very have in front of this convention, for example, no one from state officials until today, since this convention ratified by our parliament, no one from president until less powerful state officials never even published all his annual income declaration, like tax declaration, which is shameful. And they are saying, just to respond to international community, which is always criticizing, they say, well, why don't publish this income declaration? For example, president say, because committee of ministers not approved blank, like one piece of paper for which kind of information must be published. But for example, in Russia, what we saw, our partners in Russia, but my recommendation, we need to involve people, not only civil society, also politicians. We need to create some kind of creative cultures against corruption. But unfortunately, in Azerbaijan, we can't observe this public culture, but like our neighbor, Russia, which is also bigger example than Putin, which is according to the global analytical center, they have they still approximately $100 billion. The Russian politicians and Russian civil society find a way, and they are completely independent from foreign support. They start to create crowdsourcing mechanisms to promote the effective tools to fight against corruption. But in countries like Azerbaijan, Turkmenistan, or Kazakhstan, where it's difficult to mobilize the local community, I think it's responsibility from global states, which is need to support civil society, which is need to provide the skills. We don't have the skills. When one journalist understands how to make better anti-corruption investigative stories, he's arrested, jailed for a few years, and small communities don't have the power or capacity to replace them. And this is issues for Western leadership need to support activities, like anti-corruption activities in countries like in Azerbaijan, and the countries which is
priority list.
Yeah, and especially for countries which have serious problems with extra active industries, because Azerbaijan, in case of Azerbaijan, only for last 2 years we have decided to lift two important initiatives like open government partnership. We're sure for in October open government partnership decided to stop the Azerbaijani downgraded membership. We are also stopped our participation in AITI, Extra Active Industries Transparency Initiative. And with this kind of steps, when Azerbaijan just left this initiative, international business community, especially oil and gas giant like British Petroleum, still continued working in Azerbaijan and cooperated with the regime. And this is also responsibility of huge businesses, especially in extra active industries. For when all of them in Davos or in international event talking about business and human rights responsibilities, they are just to talking. They are even business don't implement this UN convention or bigger state. And until we don't have built not only this small authoritarian state, until we don't have built in European Union leadership, until we don't have strong and principled will by G8 or G7 leadership, we can't find solutions for this serious problem.
Thank you, Emin. In fact, costs of kleptocracy should be high and the highest possible on an international level, and it's a very big issue. Ana, you have 2 minutes for your key points, key recommendations.
Well, the Moldovan kleptocratic governance should not be longer bailed out on the EU taxpayers' money, as well as on the USA taxpayers' money first. All the bilateral relationships between European Community and Moldova, between USA and Moldova, should be strongly conditional. Conditionality is one of the important tools, which, as well we as we observed, are really helpful in relationship with the Republic of Moldova, because the frozen macro-financial assistance, and after that the rejected macro-financial assistance from the European Union, was the sign that this kleptocratic regime has no more legitimacy. This is very important. It's not only about money. It's about giving legitimacy. They are stealing from taxpayers in EU. They are stealing from American taxpayers. They are stealing our money. They are stealing public money. They have stolen $1 billion from the National Reserve, using three levels of judiciary, using the Prosecutor General Office and the National Anti-Corruption Center, for which European Community gave a lot of money, yeah, to build the structure of anti-corruption, and they just helped the oligarch to steal the money. And no proper investigation was conducted until now, so it's the one of the biggest conditionalities. Everybody in Moldova knows, we have a report crawl, we have a lot of international voices, and we had a lot of information already opened from different judgments held abroad. We know who is who might be responsible for the stolen billion, but proper investigation should be conducted only by pressure of European Community. And if this kind of strong conditionalities, for example, one of the biggest which we insist is the cancellation of this law, electoral law, which was adopted by this criminal parliamentary majority of Plahotniuk, the election law, which is totally dangerous for the Republic of Moldova, because if we will have this mixed system on the we will have no democratic election at all. And if such conditionalities won't be implemented, we should go to sanctions. That was my
The cost of kleptocracy should be very high, the highest possible, and also on the international level. Maybe the case of investigations against Paul Manafort in US right now, with strong questions about how he was doing lobbying for a former Ukrainian government, Yanukovych team. It was like already, it was maybe we need a kind of international FBI system and try to do investigations and to make these costs of kleptocracy the highest possible, because the national judiciary systems are not able to do it by themselves. We also can see with how difficult it is to implement some anti-corruption institutions in Ukraine, and how strong the resistance of the elite is, and it's really impossible to obtain what is announced because of this huge dissonance between what they say and what they do. So finally, maybe it should be we need some more strong financial investigations and sanctions, also conditionalities, and but followed by sanctions.
And also we have Magnitsky laws, a very important tool.
Yeah, very quickly, not waiting for the destinies. Maybe we can ask your ideas, if you have questions on some recommendations on how do you see this problem we discussed together from your point of view. Yes?
Just introduce yourself very shortly. Maybe you can start and move on.
My name is Carl Forskov from the Danish Helsinki Committee, and I will start with thanking for your interesting speeches here. One thing I will point out at your neighbor country, Georgia, and they have been in certain degree, not absolutely, but in certain degree, have locked with fighting against corruption, at least in the small scale. And I think that's a way to start. For example, giving the policemen, give the tax officers decent wages. And in your country, Azerbaijan, your country has money enough, so it will be possible to do that. That will.
It could be possible, yes, but it's all about mentality.
Can I respond to my
Just precise your question?
Yes, that would be possible in this way, at least to stop the low-level corruption. And if you can do that and get the normal people understand that now the corruption is at least partially stopped, it will give the impetus for also stopping in the higher levels.
Thank you. Any short answer?
Yeah, I just want to give recent example with Danske Bank story.
Yes, yes, you know, that's very interesting.
Yeah, it's from your state, but Danske Bank organized money laundering mechanism in between 2012 and 14 for €3 billion. And they have a profit from this money laundering only for 3 billion euros. They have a profit 115 million euros. And this has started some kind of critical discussions in Danish community. Many newspapers start to criticize because Denmark is its pioneer with less corruption in the world. Yeah. What is tragic, but Danske Bank provide money laundering possibilities to Azerbaijani ruling elite. And you say for Azerbaijan, if we have a legitimate government, we don't have a police, parliament, judgment, everything, rule of law, everything under control only for one person in the state. And in this condition, it's not Georgia have this perspective when they are, as like Dominic said, they're organized democratic transition with peaceful revolution. We don't have these issues. And in our way, it's only one way to make massive anti-corruption culture. And it's only small bribery. When all people, starting from president and according to the small state official responsible at the front of the government, this is make sense. But with anti-corruption activities, it's quite high level. You need to involve to these activities not high level, it's quite with high capacities specialists, which is have global experience, not only in one country, and you need to teach the people. And in Danske Bank, they are announced for they are apologizing in front of the Danish people, in front of the world for Danske Bank, launder money from Azerbaijan dictator, and they promise to spend this 150 million to support civil society against against corruption. They just recently, their board.
Where? Civil society, to support civil society.
It's around the world. Uh-huh. Right? And that's what now, it's a good chance. Well, you are from Danish NGO and from Azerbaijan. Let's ask this Danish bank, say, for guys, you steal the money from us. And this 150 million, but now Western donors stopped all support to anti-corruption initiative in Azerbaijan because they have a business with a dictator. But in case when civil society is able to cooperate between Danish civil society and Azerbaijan, it's good chance to asking them for guys, okay, you are still the money, you make mistake, you apologize. give this money to international communities like Transparency International, OCCRP, ICFG, to Azerbaijani civil society, and we have created this massive culture.
But we need a global bureau of investigation.
No. It's investigation, FBI. It's only nations. I'm not agree with this point. It's only nations.
Why?
Peoples able to fight against corruptions if they have a culture, if they understand for his own better life.
Yes.
Maybe you can take another second question.
Well, thank you. Sébastien Perouz, I'm a researcher working on Central Asia at George Washington University. The main question is to think how to try to make things change a little bit. And what Dominique, for example, was saying is that we need democratic reforms, or Anna, you were saying that aid should be strongly conditioned, or Emir was saying that the global community should maybe involve more into a civil society, which I totally agree. Again, I'm working on Central Asia. I'm just trying, to imagine that on Central Asia, how to bring this kind of process of democratization in the region where governments are, as you know, extremely reluctant to any change. And if you look at the situation, the geographical and political situation of Central Asia, the two main actors are Russia and China, which support systematically or almost systematically authoritarianism in Central Asia. And even more than that, the two main funders, and especially China brings billions of dollars. So if I present very briefly the pictures in Central Asia, what you have is that on the one hand you have, let's say, the European Union and the United States, which say, we're going to give you, let's say, $5-10 million, and you have to change that. You have to reform your political and economic system. And on the other hand, you have China, which brings billions of dollars, and Russia, less now with the economic crisis, but still, and which say, okay, we bring you a lot of money, but please don't change anything because your system is great. My question is, what can we do? I don't know if it's a comment. Again, I totally agree with you. I'm not criticizing the European Union or the United States. I really consider that human rights are non-negotiable. We have to put pressure on them. It's just, for me, it's hard to be optimistic on how we can really have an impact on this region, especially Moldova and Ukraine are different from Central Asia. Okay, but on Central Asia, sometimes I'm very pessimistic. So if you could just help me to be a little bit more optimistic, I would be extremely thankful. Thank you.
Unfortunately, we are pessimistic all. Ukraine and Moldova are heading to the Central Asia with an increasing speed.
Yeah, for Ukraine, if I can just comment, okay. For Ukraine it's like 50-50, because I think that Ukraine has a historical chance to go forward. But it's a very big danger to go to downgrade. So now it's like if the next year maybe some changes during the next elections, because we see some bad trends in Ukraine, but we also see that the Ukrainian society is always stopping in 2004, first revolution, and 2013-14 second revolution, now still fighting, and maybe one of the vector to work will be with our Ukrainian diaspora and expatriates and immigrants to bring back the international experience and good practices and good values and real understanding of strong democratic institutions and to try to strengthen the civil society inside the country, because I am strongly convinced we need a kind of mixed approach from international, from outside to strengthen inside, because inside it's always very it's weakest position. So it's not completely for me it's incredible that only inside the civil society and the nation and people can fight and can obtain victory against the system. So this is why we will maybe develop more about migration and diaspora during our side event this evening. Very short, if you have one to comment. Do you also have a question? No?
And we can ask our guest about what are you thinking about sanctions? Because I strongly agree with you when you are speaking that, okay, your bank community just recently refused to give 100 million to Moldova. Just 100. Erdogan is giving billions. So, Plahotniuk will be doing everything to expel the Turkish citizen, to breach all the rules of law, as he is, he's okay. He is just, he wants to live in such a house and to receive also money. Central Russia, yeah, we've been working a time with our colleagues from Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Turkmenia, and we know that it's worse. But I repeat, okay, not Ukraine, Moldova is getting, is heading there. But so maybe sanctions will help us. What do you think about strong sanctions, to personal sanctions, to limit access in European community, in US, to block their accounts, to find all over the world the luxury villas and the luxury business which is hidden, but it's the, with the provenience from the stolen in our country's money.
Yeah, Emil, do you support this idea?
I have a different vision. First of all, I don't believe for EU or US start to arrest all these villas, etc., etc., etc. And especially for current regime, when it's a ruling floor, no one needs to take, because all of them have one point. Okay, this man is not good man, but our man, sometimes. They don't make anything against us. It's better to have another situation. For example, what you say, try to conclude. No one inexperienced with Azerbaijan started, all European leadership knows. For example, France knows what they use its territory for luxury, buying luxury property. The UK knows, but still, Prime Minister of UK, Theresa May, hosted Aleph in down street, or Macron hosted Aleph in Elysee Palace. And only one way, when you ask me for about mentality and hopelessness with Central Asia, as like former Soviet, say, we have the same situation with Belarus. With Belarus is also kleptocracy. Why this kleptocracy works successful? Because people don't know what for their steal money. Sometimes they are believe for their steal money, but for some good things, for some national ideas to make nations stronger, like Russian people believe for, yes, we know for Putin steal money, but they make, they fight against like Western imperialism. Or Central Asia. Central Asia people, all of this are seriously afraid public reactions. When people really believe for they are stealing his own money and they have to right to live better, the system starts to crash immediately. But people still don't know because the countries don't have free media, these countries don't have even chance to create it. Independent or critical media, and now we have many chances to create these media in our state. But if you look to Turkmenistan or Uzbekistan, civil society, how many independent media initiatives supported by US or European Union? Zero for last 5 years, and even one media initiative like global media initiative like OCCRP able change to global situation with fighting against corruption. They start to public discussions in the Denmark, in EU, in US, and step by step situation change. But you need to also focus again. I believe if before I believe to sanctions for US must make our job for us to cut all possibilities for these dictators. If the US cut this possibility, they are running to China. Like, if SWIFT blocks, this amount, and that's how dictators start to move. When they understand, well, they have issues with sanctions, they start to diversify his stealing money. They start to accumulate this money in China, in United Arab Emirates, not in the US or in Europe anymore. That's why only one way, work with people, with nations inside the countries. That's my point. Thank you.
We have not more time. Thank you very much, and let's continue the discussion later. And this evening we will try to develop maybe some ideas on how to connect and if migration and expatriates and diaspora can have a role for helping their origins country on working and fighting for better democracy. Thank you very much.